Lisa Winger. Art was one of my students in the solar class, and has been very generous in terms of supporting the research that I do, and I'm very appreciative. Very successful man. Well, let's see. I can say a few things. I look back over my time. How many hours?
50 minutes, Mel.
Yeah, oh, that's fine. That's fine. I want to talk about tenacity, of all things. And I'll start with an example. I don't know if I can go beyond one example. When I finished my research in low temperature plasma physics, I was looking for something to do, and there were jobs plenty galore in the area, but I didn't want to work into the military kind of situation. And then this energy thing surfaced, and I started looking at that. Then I got involved with environmental studies. And so I looked at energy and I said, what am I going to do about energy? What do you do? I mean, oddly enough, that we wanted to get more carbon fuel in because of these lines to gas stations in the early 70s. And, I didn't pay too much attention to that. So I looked into solar. And I came to the conclusion that wind would be very interesting to do. Wind has a higher thermodynamic quality to it than other forms of solar energy. And so I started measuring wind, and one of the things that I first did was to recognize that the ground, the wind doesn't blow. And as you go farther and farther higher, it blows more and more, and eventually the jet stream. And so I got together with Goodyear Tire and Blimp, and we put together a publication on putting turbines on blimps. This is the early 70s. And it got published in the Journal of Aircraft. And lo and behold, I find that the Israelis have already done that to spy on Egypt. And they use the wind turbine to charge up their electronics. And that was kind of interesting. So I continued with this wind thing, and I looked at all the wind on the Channel Islands. And this was before it was a marine sanctuary. And believe me, there's a lot of wind out there. San Miguel, Santa Rosa, and I got to know the owner of Santa Rosa, the Vale Victor company. And this once reminds me of this story. The superintendent of the Park Service came out and looked, was with the Isle Vale, and myself, and we're looking at this, and he's talking about the impact of wind energy. And I said to him, well, all you have to do is just put them underground. But what I did is I traced the wind from San Miguel to the mainland, and I come head on with the Bixby Ranch, Sun Ranch, and Vandenberg Air Force Base. So I said, I want to measure the wind on Vandenberg Air Force. You know, they had a space shuttle launch there, and they had a wind wall to keep the wind off the spaceship as it started to move, so it doesn't get off course. So I thought this would be an interesting place to go. So I made the connections to meet with the commanding general in his cabinet. You know, I went there with a colleague of mine, and we made them a presentation. And my God, there must have been 16 of the general's cabinet. And they listened to me. I gave them a proposal, and they said no. I didn't like that answer. So I started fishing around and playing a little politics, and I was able to make a connection directly to the Secretary of Defense. The guy's name I still remember, Vernon Orr, under Reagan. And so this connection carried my proposal to the Secretary of Defense, and he said yes. And so I did the study, and it's windy there, believe me. But I didn't want to really run into that general. unfortunately. But it was the tenacity that I persevered and was able to bring that off. And I still believe that area and the surrounding ranch and then even offshore is extremely windy commercially, as you have on San Miguel. But now that's off the list for lots of reasons. San Miguel is a marine sanctuary. Even before it was a marine sanctuary because of the rookery for seals and sea lions and so forth and so on. So it pays to persevere, and it makes things happen. There have been other examples. There is one other story I'd like to say in terms of the teaching. 1 year I was in charge of seminars, and I was able to secure Ruckel's house to come and speak. And he came, and we had him over for dinner and with the faculty, and it was a very successful undertaking. Especially, I got the inside track on Saturday Night Massacre with President Nixon, which is kind of reminiscent of what we're kind of going through now, which is interesting. But what I find that Ruckel's House was the first and twice director of the EPA, still active in his 80s, higher 80s. Yes, his daughter, Mary, who was a professor at Stanford. She was 11 years old when he first became the director of the EPA, and she's a very ardent environmentalist, and perhaps maybe we should consider her for this 50-year anniversary coming up. Very successful woman. So Ruckel's House is with us, and still, and it was an honor to meet him. And I really appreciate there are other stories, but I think I've reached my time limit. Thank you all for these very nice comments. I just wonder who this guy that they're talking about is. I really appreciate it. I thank my wife, I thank my family, and I'm so happy to be here. Thank you.